as her tears began to fall. She took out pen and paper as to trace her memories. And she looked up to heaven, and the words she said were these. She said, "Lord, my boy was special, and he meant so much to me. And oh, I'd love to see him just one more time, you see. All I have are the memories and the moments to recall. But Lord, could you tell him that he's more than a name on the wall?" She said he really missed the family and being home on Christmas Day. And he died for God and country in a place so far away. I remember just a little boy playing war since he was three. But Lord, this time I know he's not coming home to me. She said, "Lord, my boy was special, he meant so much to me. And oh, I'd love to see him, but I know it just can't be. So I thank you for my memories and the moments to recall. But Lord, could you tell him that he's more than a name on the wall? Lord, could you tell him that he's more than a name on the wall?"
Thank you, Dan. We do not have a lot of announcements this morning. So I am actually going to also read prayer requests right now because we have a lot of those. First, our announcements. The vertical lift donations, the pledges and donations are coming in. It looks like we had about over 52,000 donated, thank you, or pledged. And the pledge slips are at the back of the church if you are interested in pledging. There are no Bible study classes on Thursday. The Tuesday class is meeting still. They need to finish the book of Revelation, correct? On Tuesday, but no Bible study on Thursday. And next week, please come and show your support for the youth and others who are joining the church next Sunday. We have a nice group, and they would love to see you there and supporting them. I also wanted to say thank you to the fallen who have served our country, and to the families of those who gave that sacrifice. Happy Memorial Day. Judy Shepherd and Diane Birch, their brother is having a second surgery on the same knee that he had surgery on before. That's on Tuesday. Niece Brenda is doing well after her surgery, so that's a praise. Continue prayers. Their brother-in-law, Steve, is doing well after his surgery, so please continue keeping him in your prayers. from Cheryl Taylor Bennett, who is Melissa DiPuccio's 6-year-old grandson. He had a colonoscopy. We prayed about him either last week or a couple weeks ago. That colonoscopy showed Crohn's disease. So keep that family in your prayers. Taylor Skidmore, who is a nephew of Cheryl Taylor, has a mutated gene, and that's been identified in his blood. He will be in the hospital for 6 more weeks, and he has a couple of siblings, I think, who are missing him very much. So keep that family in your prayers. And Michael Gillett, his ferritin levels were extremely high, and when that happens, it can cause serious organ damage. So please keep him and your family, or his family, in your prayers. And Cheryl Taylor had cataracts removed, so she is not with us today. But if you could keep her healing in your prayers as well. Carolyn Lindsay has a biopsy this week. Ed and Diana Heterick and Larry and Denise Jarman all need prayers. That's from Howard and Rosalind Hughes. Betty Creighton's granddaughter and her family are traveling to Trinidad, so please pray for safe travels for those, for them. Miranda Boston, she's an SLP for Claremont County. She was injured in a car accident on Tuesday, so keep her and her family in your prayers. And for all of the children who are out of school for the summer, please pray that they can rely on the schools as a place of love, structure, and meals. Hopefully the schools are still doing that. I know ours does periodically through the summer, so please keep those children in your prayers. Now let us welcome Christ and the Holy Spirit into our hearts and into this room with silent prayer. In the name of our Heavenly Father, amen. I will be reading from Psalm 24, 3 through 6 this morning. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god. They will receive blessings from the Lord and vindication from God, their Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, God of Jacob. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And if the ushers would come forward for the offering, please.
Father in heaven, we give you praise for all of the gifts you give to us. Now, Lord, we present our tithes and our offerings to you this morning. Bless each gift and each giver and these who have waited on your congregation, Lord, we ask in thy name. Amen. Let's remain standing as we worship the Lord. Father in heaven, how wonderful it is to be in your house, Lord, and among your people. To know, Lord, that your very presence is in our midst. Lord, we just lift your name above every name. For your Lord are above every name. You have all power. You have all glory as yours. You alone are worthy. You alone, Father, have created the heavens and the earth. And Lord, Jesus Christ alone is the way to the Father. He is the door. Father, may we come through him. We know that in Christ we have life, we have grace and forgiveness of our sins. And Father, we just ask that even now your Holy Spirit might fill us, that, Lord, you might anoint us, that we might be your people, and that your Holy Spirit might work through us, Lord, to reach this community and our world for Jesus Christ. Lord, you've given us a great commission, and you've given us all that we need. You've given us the power that we need through the Spirit. You've given us the grace that we need through Jesus Christ and his death on the cross. Now, Lord, may we come to you. May we surrender everything in our lives to you. And may Jesus Christ be Lord. For this is his house, and it's in his name we pray. Amen. It's always good when we have those who are coming and presenting their children to be dedicated to the Lord this morning. And then we also have one that will be coming in a moment to be baptized into the Christian faith. And so I would invite you to come and to bring Hayden on up at this time. The scriptures bear witness of the fact that godly parents of old dedicated their children to the Lord in his service. Hannah brought her child Samuel and dedicated him to God in the service of his house. At the time of purification, according to the law of Moses, Joseph and Mary presented the boy Jesus in the temple at Jerusalem in an act of dedication. We're confident, therefore, of divine approval today as this child is brought to the church to be dedicated to God in his service. It is our duty as a Christian congregation to support these parents in the act of dedication and to assist them in the spiritual nurture of this child. You're presenting this child for dedication to God. In so doing, you acknowledge this child to be a gift from God, for whose nurture and spiritual welfare you are responsible. It is proper that you declare your purpose to lead her in the way of Jesus Christ by answering the following questions before this congregation. Will you give an example of a Christian life and instruct and guide this child in Christian living? If so, we will with the help of God. Will you seek to lead her to a personal acceptance of Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord and endeavor to bring her into the membership of the church? If so, answer, we will by the help of God.
We will by the help of God.
This question is addressed to you as a congregation. Do you as a congregation accept the responsibility of assisting these parents in the fulfillment of these dedication vows? If so, answer, we will with the help of God.
We will with the help of God.
Come here, honey. Hayden Ray Jones, we dedicate you to the Lord and dedicate you to his service in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray. Almighty God, we thank you that under the ministry of thy Spirit, these parents have been led to dedicate this child to thee. Let thy blessing rest upon this child, we pray, and upon these parents who have dedicated her here to thee. Guide us, we humbly pray, both parents and congregation, in our common ministry to this child, that she may be led in the ways of righteousness, nurtured in the things of the Spirit, and guided into a personal acceptance of Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. Make her strong in her purpose to do right and grant her victory over evil. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. We also have one coming who was dedicated as an infant and is now coming to be baptized into the Christian faith. Austin. Dearly beloved, as much as all men have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and our Savior Christ said, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. I beseech you to call upon God the Father through our Lord Jesus Christ, that of his bounteous goodness he will grant that this person may receive the forgiveness of his sins, be baptized with water in the Holy Spirit, and may be received into Christ's holy church and be made a living member of the same. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you're the aid of all who need, the helper of all who call upon thee for comfort, the life of all who believe in the resurrection of the dead. We call upon thee for this thy servant, that he may, in coming to the holy baptism, may receive remission of his sins and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Receive him, O Lord, as you have promised by your beloved Son, and grant that he may be faithful to you all the days of his life, and finally come to the eternal kingdom which you have promised through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, beloved, you have come here desiring to receive holy baptism. We prayed that God, through our Lord Jesus, would grant to receive you, release you from sin, sanctify you with the Holy Spirit, and give you the kingdom of heaven and everlasting life. Do you truly and earnestly repent of your sins and accept Jesus Christ as your Savior? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, and in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
Do you desire to be baptized into this faith? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
Will you then obediently keep God's holy will and commandments and walk in the same all the days of your life? If so, answer, I will with the help of God.
I will with the help of God.
Let us pray. Lord, merciful God, grant that all sinful affection may die in this thy servant, that all things belonging to your Spirit may live and grow in him. Grant that he may have the power and strength to triumph over evil, may receive the fullness of your grace, and ever remain in the number of your faithful and beloved children. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please state your full name. William Austin Jones, I baptize thee in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Will the congregation rise? Brethren of the household of faith, I commend to your love and care this person whom we this day recognize as a member of the family of God. Will you endeavor so to live that he may grow in the knowledge and love of God the Father through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? If so, answer, we will with the help of God.
We will with the help of God.
Let us pray. Father in heaven, may we keep the vows that we make this day. We make them in your very presence. May your blessings fall upon these children and on this congregation, we pray, that we might keep the vow that we've made and that we might ever remain true children of thine. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. going to dismiss for Junior Church at this time. This mic also, guys. Most of you know that this week was our first full annual conference. We had a setting up annual conference for two days in the fall for our new denomination. And then we had a quick one day, a few months ago, where we elected our delegates to General Conference that will take place in the fall. But then we had our first full conference this week. It met up in Mount Vernon, Ohio, on the campus there of Mount Vernon Nazarene College is where we were. And it was such a wonderful thing. We had two of us pastors, two lay delegates that were there for the conference. And so I'm going to invite them to come on up, Janet and Elise and James. And they were there for the conference. And we just wanted to share a few things about you. And then I am going to go to Deuteronomy chapter 1 in a moment or two. But I wanted them to share... Well, I'll let them see what they think. They know where I was, but it was such a blessing. Annual conference is a blessing to go to, and I'll let them share a moment or so, and at least go ahead and share your thoughts.
Well, annual conference to me in the past had been something that was, well, you had to go do it, because that was just part of the job. But this annual conference was filled with the Holy Spirit, and you just came home with such a high. The things that we experienced that I will share with you as we had four Bible studies, and we had some powerful preaching, but the first thing we did was pray. So we prayed, we studied, and we worshiped our God. And I would leave you with these high notes from our studies, and I'll put some write-ups in our newsletter, so watch for that. But these were the key phrases. Enough already. Go do what God says. Take the land. Build his altar. Trust him. Do not stop, no matter what. And they were in capital letters, with periods in between each piece. It is time to move forward. The Spirit is leading powerfully, not just here in the United States, but around the world. God is on the move and in a revival.
They also took up a miracle offering for students that want to become pastors in Kenya. We, as a church, pledged $1,200 that will take care of one student for college credits for 1 year. And on another high note, it was announced that in 2025, the youth will also be a part of the annual conference. So any youth that are interested, let Pastor know.
One of the things that I was thinking about is what to tell you. As a longtime annual conference delegate for many years in the UMC, this is the first time I can say that I could let my guard down. You weren't waiting or looking to see what the alternative motive was of the people. Every speaker was prayed over. Every thought, the church is moving and it's leading by the Spirit. In that spirit, I would ask that all of you be in prayer the next few months as we prepare for the General Conference, that it's led by God and not by people, that we don't create a 2.0. but it was an awesome experience.
All based on Nehemiah and the rebuilding.
The rebuilding of the wall. James is also going to be a delegate to General Conference in Costa Rica in the fall, so we'll be wanting to pray for James as he goes down there. And it would be good to support him financially a little bit too for that trip. So he's also leaving for Colombia, and he'll be in Colombia for 2 weeks here in the next couple weeks with Beth leading our teams down there. So we want to be in prayer for them over that, as the teams as well. We will be dedicating our teams next week. We have two teams going down, and about seven teams between the two, I think. I think you have six or five in the first one.
I think we all have
five in the first and three in the next one. Yeah. So, yeah. So it's going to be a really good thing for them. Conference, as these can testify, was wonderful. I mean, we spent maybe an hour and a half total on business the whole week, and the rest was in worship and study and prayer, and it was marvelous to see over 1,000 delegates there. We have about 580 churches, I think, now in our conference that are all global, in our Global Methodist Conference, which is West Allegheny Conference is the name of our conference, and it was just so powerful. The worship. A lot of you were down at the Asbury Revival back in the, been a year now, I guess, in the spring. But the worship was like being at the revival. It was just so powerful. And the Spirit was just all around. And when you see that many people just worshiping, it was incredible. We had a symphony of prayer the one evening where everybody in the congregation prayed out loud at the top of their lungs. And I mean, if you can imagine 1,000 people praying out and calling on the Lord all at the same time, it was a powerful, moving experience. It was led by one of our Korean pastors. That's the way they pray in Korea. And it was a powerful experience to be a part of. We're in the right place. And it's moving. The church is growing. We're adding new people, and the church is growing. Our congregation has been growing. This is a little bit of a down, I suppose, because of the weekend and the holiday. But, you know, we've been growing quite a bit ourselves here, but it's happening all across the Global Methodist Church. And it's just powerful what God is doing, and just the dedication to go. As they mentioned, the idea was, let's build the walls. Let's build the altar. Let's move forward. So I was going to read a passage. You guys can sit down if you like, or if you want to add something, go ahead.
I want to just add that another piece was that it's centered in the local church. What we here want to do in ministry for God is what the Global Methodist Church wants us to do. It is not top-heavy. It's not coming from a leadership up there. We are the leaders, each and every one of us here.
Right. Thank you. We don't have a lot of business to report because we didn't do a lot of business. We worshiped. And everybody came back enthused and ready to go. And the offering was incredible. We're adopting Kenya as a co-conference with ours. And because they need the help there. And I don't know if you're aware, but the students in the United Methodist, in the Global Methodists, they're refusing to allow them to attend Africa University, which we built as United Methodists. It's a United Methodist-run university, which was serving Africa, and they're refusing to allow any of the global students to attend. So we've started a new school. And for $1,200 a year, it'll take care of one student. And so when we were getting the pledging, and this was the drive of the miracle offering this year, we kind of looked at each other and said, our church hasn't made a pledge, but we're going to pledge for the church. You need to come through for us. But we're going to pledge $1,200 and cover one student for a year. And if we would all do that, I think we can do it, can't we? Are you willing to do that? We can do that. And let's cover one student a year. These are pastors that are being trained for the church there in Kenya. And we need to be a part of that. You know, we've been doing a good bit. I hope they're building the church right now in Colombia so that when we go down here in a few weeks, some of it at least is built. And are they doing it, James? Are they on it already, or what's going on there? I think they are. We raised the money back in October through the end of the year, and you raised $55,000, the church did. The thrust of the conference was it's time to go to work. It's time to get busy. It's time to grow. It's time to win souls. It's time to win the community for Jesus Christ. I want to read to you in Deuteronomy chapter 1. This was a passage that was the theme of one of the teachings during the week, one of the sermons. And Carolyn Moore, professor at Asbury Seminary, gave us two wonderful sermons, and Bill Arnold and Dave Watson, they're also professors, one at United, one at Asbury, and they gave wonderful Bible teaching to us through the week. But this passage came up, and along with Nehemiah and Ezra and some passages in the New Testament, became kind of a theme for us. And I'm reading from verse 6. It uses the word Horeb here, but you need to know that Horeb is the Jewish name for Mount Sinai. So we're talking Mount Sinai, where God gave the Ten Commandments to Moses. So if you will look at it with me in verse 6. The Lord our God said to us at Horeb, you have stayed long enough at this mountain. Break camp and advance into the hill country of the Amorites. Go to all the neighboring peoples in the Arabah, in the mountains, in the western foothills, in the Negev, and along the coast to the land of the Canaanites, and to Lebanon as far as the great river, the Euphrates. See, I have given you this land. Go in and take possession of the land that the Lord swore he would give to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and to their descendants after them. Let's have a word of prayer. And then I want to, Father in heaven, your word is true. And Lord, your word is to us. Challenge us, Lord. Speak to us this morning, we pray. We ask it in your name. Amen. I know the time's late, but I'm not going to go long. But pay attention, okay? It's the word of the Lord to us. You know, as we were reading this, I realized this is God speaking to us. There's a time when they've been at the mountain. God had been on the mountain, the thunder, the lightning, the smoke, the wonder of it all. But there comes a time after you've met with God and heard the voice of God, he's spoken to you. There comes a time when it's time to leave the mountain now and go take the land. Horeb, Mount Sinai, is not the promised land. That's the preparatory place. That's where God met, gave them his law. That's where God formed a covenant with them. But that land lay out there for them to take. That was not the promised land. They needed now to go and take the land. Take the promised land. And take it. God had promised it to them. And it was time to go and move forward. And I would say to you this morning, you know, we worship, we get Bible studies, we get ourselves prepared, we pray together, we baptize our children, we take them into the church, we teach, we train. There comes a time when we have to go out and take the land. We can't stay on the mountain. The call is to win the community for Jesus Christ. The call is to go into the world and make disciples out of Jesus Christ. And there comes a time we've got to get off the mountain, away from the mountain, and start to move into the land and take the people on the land. And as I was thinking about this, and as the week was going on, it just kept coming back. I sat down with a friend of mine who's pastoring in Jackson now at the Global Methodist Church there, but Tim and I have known each other for a long time. He followed me at Portsmouth. We moved out one day. He moved into our house the next day with his family. And Tim's been a good friend since that time to me. But I was sat down with Tim, and then there was a bunch of women that sat down. I didn't know who they were. We got talking, and I saw the one had a Cincinnati shirt on, and I thought it was a red shirt. I said, "You must be from Cincinnati." Well, they were all from Mount Nebo and Goshen, the two churches. Some of them were in the church of Mount Nebo, and the pastor at Goshen, and some of them, they were there. And we got into a conversation together about the land and all. And then I went back to the sanctuary, and I sat down, and two people I didn't know asked me to let them through, and so they could sit down beside me. We got to talking, and he's the pastor at Mount Orb and another church in Brown County. And he told me that, and I didn't know who they were. And then I sat down for lunch the next day, and the pastor at Mount Pisgah was there at the table across from me. And I'm realizing these were all churches around us. They told me that all the Methodist churches, except for two in Brown County, pulled out. Three of them stayed independent. The rest all became Global Methodists with us. And as I was talking with them, I realized this. God wants us to take the land. And he began to put in my mind, I could get a picture that you and I, our territory goes from Williamsburg down to Batavia and on down to Summerside, and then everything south, all the way to the river. That's our land. And we've got to take it for Jesus Christ. We've got to move away from the mountain and take the land and claim it for Jesus Christ and bring people to him. Bring them in so that they can worship with us. We talk sometimes about the dread of the summer months when it seems things are down, and you know, some of them don't like to go to the two services because it cuts out so many from this service and makes it seem like there are fewer, and it kind of breaks our momentum. But there's a solution to that. Everybody brings somebody new in. And we'll actually have more than we have now. Fill it. Fill it with the people that we're talking to and bringing in, that we're trying to reach for Jesus Christ. After all, that is our commission, isn't it? Go into the world, make disciples. Bring them in, make disciples out of them, baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Now, it's been wonderful, so many of you that have come in, and next week we've got four joining the church that have been in catechism, Austin and three others, Mia and some of the others, and Reagan and Emerson. They're all going to be joining the church next week. And a lot of you have come in from other churches, and you've transferred your membership. I don't know how many we've had join since January. But it's been a large number. It's been about 15 or 16 change membership and join our church. And next week, I may have everybody stand that's come in the last year and a half and have become changed their membership, become part of the church. It's like God is positioning us together. But these are already churched people. These are people who know Jesus Christ, and they're gathering together. And it seems to me he's gathering us together so that we can now go out and reach the lost. the ones that don't go to church anywhere, the ones that don't know Jesus Christ, the ones that don't believe, and bring them in and baptize them into the name of Jesus Christ. That's our call as a church. One last thing. In the United Methodist Church, and I hope it won't be true for us together now, but in a year's time, 60% of our churches never baptized a single person. And never received a single member by confession of faith, which means that's a first time joining the church. All the members we got were transfers for most churches. They weren't winning anyone to Jesus Christ. And I remember the Diaz, who was a friend of mine. Well, he's kind of a friend of mine. Actually, he sent me to the church I was going to, which was ultra-liberal and had been that way for a long time, and told me, I want you to go in, shake it up, and turn it in a different direction. That's always a fun assignment for a pastor. And, of course, my question was, will you have my back if you do that? And he said he would, and he did until he retired 2 years later. And then I was kind of on my own after that. But I remember him sharing with me, said he was in one of the churches. It was a country church. Not a big church, but they had a lot, mostly older, all older people in it. And he brought this to their attention, that in that year's time, they hadn't baptized a single person. And one of their leaders told him, he said, well, look at us, look at our age. How in the world are we going to have a baby? You hear that? Their whole concept was that the only time you baptize is when somebody has a baby and you baptize the baby. The idea that you might actually in a year's time win somebody to Jesus Christ and baptize it wasn't even there. When's the last time you led someone to Jesus Christ? Or even when's the last time you brought someone who was unchurched and not a Christian and got them into the church and they were wanted even at the church and became a Christian? When's the last time? That's our call. And if we're going to win the community and if we're going to take the land, we've got to take seriously the unchurched. We've got to take our call seriously. And we've got to begin to talk to people about Jesus Christ. Let me say this to you this morning. The statistics on this are just overwhelming. You can have a wonderful sign. You can have a wonderful website. But 90% of the people that come to your church and join your church come because somebody in the church invited them. Think back on your own life. What brought you to the church? Maybe your parents dragged you along when you were a kid. We come because people invite. And if we're excited about Jesus Christ, it's natural to talk about Jesus to people that we work with and that we live next to. And if we have hearts that really care about people, then we can't stand by and watch them pass into a lost eternity. We got to get serious about winning souls, and we got to get serious about taking the land. And Jesus Christ is able to give us the land. We just have to believe him. You remember the problem the Israelites had? They wouldn't believe. They got right up to the edge of the land, and they sent the spies in. Two of the spies came back and said, we can take the land. God will give it to us. 10 of them said, we can't do it. There's giants in the land and their cities are walled. And they listened to the 10. And so they wandered for 40 years. This church has been sitting here since, what, 1790? It's the second oldest church in the Northwest Territory, Methodist Church in the Northwest Territory. And we still haven't taken the land. We got to believe. What he calls us to do, he will do through us. And he'll give us the power. He'll give us the strength. If you determine to witness and to win somebody for Jesus Christ, he will give you what you need. He'll give you the strength. He'll give you the power. He'll send you to the right people that you can share with, because their life will be similar to yours, maybe. Holy Spirit is able to do all of that. But we've got to be serious about winning souls. If the church is to move forwards, we've got to win people. It's time to get off the mountain and take the land and bring people to Jesus Christ. This time next year, wouldn't it be wonderful to have 100 or more people that we have won to Jesus Christ and baptized into the kingdom? And what a difference that would make. Only happens when you and I carry out our mandate by Christ to go into the world and make disciples. The pastor is supposed to equip the saints and train them. And then they're the ones that win the souls for Jesus Christ. Let's do it. We can do it. You and I can't do it on our own strength, but Christ can do it. And the Holy Spirit can do it. He can reach the 20 to 40-year-olds even. You and I may not have a clue how to do it, but he can do it. Let's get on board with the Holy Spirit. And as we get on board with the Holy Spirit, and as all the other churches across our denomination get on board, what a great revival there could be sweep through this area. And through the whole West Allegheny Conference, which includes all of Ohio and half of Pennsylvania. Great revival. Let's pray for it. Let's believe for it. Let's make ourselves available so that God can use us to win people to Christ. Amen? Amen. That's our call, folks. Let's take the land. Father in heaven, you are God. We thank you for your power. We know, Lord, that there's nothing impossible for you. And you've called us to win the people in this community, to win the people in this area to Jesus Christ. Father, don't let us sit in our building, Father. Let us go out and win them. And then bring them in and train them. Help them to grow in their faith. And then send them out to win souls too, Lord. Father, may that be the work of your church. That's what your church is here for. And so, Father, may your will be done in our lives just as it's done in heaven. We pray, Lord, in your name. Amen. Let's stand and join our closing song. In heaven, Go with us from this place. You've called us, you send us, and you promise to go with us. So may the Holy Spirit fill our hearts and lives. And Lord, we just pray that this might be a week when we're able to talk to and witness to many unbelievers around us. And Father, you prepare the fruit, we pray. We ask it in your name. Amen.